This screencast is the first step in creating calibration curves for the thermistor. We assume you've made the calibration measurements and you have those values available. We're going to first examine the quality of those measurements with histograms. Later, in a second part, we're going to do the curve fits. The top image shows circuit diagram for the thermistor voltage divider. An analog input channel is used on the Arduino to make a measurement of voltage across the fixed resistor. By varying the environment that the thermistor is exposed to, you will get a different output. As the temperature of the thermistor increases, the output increases. The lower diagram shows the calibration process. The output of the thermistor probe is compared to the measurement made by a standard kitchen thermometer. Both of these are placed inside a water environment. In this case, we use an insulated mug, and we mix various temperature water samples and compare the output of the voltage divider to the temperature indicated by the thermometer. Presumably, you've already done that, and you have sets of data for readings at different temperatures. The table at the right represents the data that you've collected. Consider this to be a matrix, or probably you've stored this data in Excel. The first row is the value of temperature for each of the calibration experiments, in other words, each mixture of water. The column underneath the first row represents the repeated measurements by the Arduino of the output of the voltage divider. Each column would be a different temperature. So you've done this by running the experiment, copying the output of the serial monitor into an Excel spreadsheet. When you want to save this, you first save it as an Excel worksheet, and then export the worksheet as a tab-delimited text file. The calibration data reduction follows these steps. You read the data from the previous slide into MATLAB. To investigate the quality of that data, you're going to plot histograms for each reading, each temperature setting of the calibration experiment. Inspecting the histograms allows you to determine that the data is good, and then you can compute the mean of each column of raw readings. And then the question is how to convert that into a function. Step 4 describes making a curve fit of voltage as a function of temperature. Step 5 is useful because that produces a function that you can use in your temperature control algorithm. So let's suppose that we've then exported the data into a plain text file. Here we're going to call it thermistordata.txt. What you see here are a few MATLAB statements, and I'm walking you through the operations that we'll later put into a M file. The load command reads the data in thermistordata.txt. We then, for convenience, copy the first row into a new variable called t. T equals d parentheses 1 comma colon parentheses extracts the first row. The colon is a wildcard, and the indexes of d are row first and then column. So the first row and then all the columns. And then after T, we created a new matrix variable V, which has all the remaining rows. So the two colon end for row indexes say that I want the second row to the last row, and the colon for the column indices say that I want all the columns. So what we've done is we've moved data from D, which is from the load command, and copied it into two working variables. The next step is to compute the mean of the columns, and that's simply done with VAV equals mean of V. MATLAB has an assumption that you're going to operate on columns by default. As indicated by the diagram to the right, the VAV equals mean of V operation computes the column-wise mean, so each column has a mean value stored as one element of VAVE. VAVE is a row vector with NC elements. What we have are two relatively short vectors now, row vectors. VAV as a function of T gives us the summary of the calibration experiment as it was performed, and T equals G of VAV, the bottommost equation, represents the function that we want to use. We want to be able to measure the output of the voltage divider and give some correlation function, some calibration function, that value, and have the T be the result. Before we dive into the actual curve fit, though, it's very good to look at your data. Since this is so easy to do in MATLAB, we inspect the data by computing the histogram. We've made many, many readings, I typically will do 50 to 100 readings at each calibration temperature and then store that data in the matrix. So that's why we have this table representation in the preceding slides. And it's easy, very easy to compute the average. You can just calculate the average of any set of numbers. And the question is, does that mean anything? Well, we want to look at the histograms, and the histograms allow us to assess whether a mean is an appropriate representation of that data. So each column is a set of readings, and we want to make histograms of the columns. Here's the result of the histogram of the first column of a data set that I collected. V colon 1 is a vector. So the wild card in the first entry, the first index, means give me all the rows in this matrix. Second index says give me just the first column. So V colon 1 represents the entire first column of data. And we simply say histogram of V colon comma 1 and produces the plot to the right. I've also shown the axis labeling commands that remind us which values go on which axes. The histogram sort of looks good. I mean, there's a big hump in the middle, and it would say, you know, this is not an unreasonable set of data from which to extract a mean, but look at the horizontal axis. The data is extremely narrowly clumped from 739.1 to 739.6. These are analog readings, and the entire analog reading scale is 0 to 1023. So what we have is a very narrow range of data at this particular temperature. Let's look at the other data. This slide shows the first column histogram and the second column histogram. The lower plot is obtained with histogram V colon comma 2. The colon again is the wild card. Now 2 indicates the second column. And that histogram also has a central tendency, which is good, and all the values are in a very narrow range, 665 to 665.5. It turns out that the data set that I have here has an extremely well-behaved set of analog input readings for the calibration data. Because we're wanting to be careful, we'd want to do the histogram of all our data, and that could get tedious to do it by hand, so we're going to automate that process. This is very easy to do in MATLAB. The size command returns a two-element vector. The first element is the number of rows, the second element is the number of columns. However, if we use this alternative version, size v comma 2, we just get one of those values, in this case the second value, which is the number of columns. So nc equals size v comma 2 stores the number of columns in v in the variable nc, and that gives us a very nice loop down below here. Extract the columns one at a time with the index j. The loop over and over j, for j equals 1 to nc, simply says march across the V matrix and operate on each column one at a time. So we draw a histogram of V colon comma j. Before we do that, we issue a figure command, and that opens up a new figure window so that MATLAB doesn't keep replacing the results from the previous plot. So what's nice about this very simple bit of code, is that it automatically adjusts to the number of columns and rows. We didn't say ahead of time, we don't have to click on a mouse and say, oh, operate over this range, say in an Excel spreadsheet. We simply read the data in to a matrix, and all the preceding operations don't presume anything about the size of that matrix, how many columns, how many rows you have. The next operation here is to figure out how to display all these histograms. There is an ability to put multiple plots in a single figure window, and that's done with the subplot command. In general, subplot has three inputs. The first is the total number of rows in an array. The second is the number of columns in an array. So by array, I mean a rectangular arrangement of plots, as shown in the bottom right corner. So n row is the number of rows of plot images, and col is the number of columns of plot images, and p is an index that tells us which of these we're working with. You can see three examples here of the subplot command. Subplot 2 comma 1 says I want an arrangement of two rows, one column. That means two plots, one above each other. Subplot 3 comma 2 says I want three rows with two columns, and subplot np row comma 2 says I want some variable number, np row, and two columns. And for each of these sequences, we we step through the specific image that we want to work on with the P variable. Here's a simple bit of MATLAB code that does that. As before, NC is size V2, so we've extracted the number of columns. We make a calculation here. NP row is NC divided by 2. That's the number of columns divided by 2. So that should give us the number of rows. And to be safe, we use the seal command, which is round up. So we're going to get a value of NC divided by 2, and then we're going to round up in case the last row is not full. This simple loop, as before, we're going to loop over the number of columns. Before we compute the histogram, we're going to issue the subplot command, and notice the last argument of the subplot command is J, so that allows us to step through the individual data sets, the individual histograms. And the last row, ylim 0, 40, says we want to make sure all the y-axis limits are the same. That allows us to make comparison. Now, for your data, you will probably need to adjust the value of 40 to something other, depending on how many data you've measured. You'll see whether the scale on the y-axis is not appropriate for your data. The next slide shows a complete MATLAB program that mass produces these histograms. The function name is thermistor histograms. It has one input argument, fname, which is the name of a file, and the first executable line here says if nargin is less than 1, fname is thermistordata.txt. This is a nice feature of MATLAB. Say we're developing our code and we have a sample data set, that would be thermistordata.txt, and we can simply assume that that's the text file. We don't have to type the long text file name when we run the program. On the other hand, after the code is working, we can supply other text files. The first block of statements here have to do with loading the data and copying them into some working arrays. As before, we copy the first row into the temperature vector. The V equals D of 2, end, colon statement copies all the columns below the first row. Vav stores the average value of each column in V. Vmed stores the median value. Vstd stores the standard deviation. We're going to print these for each of the columns as a way to summarize the data set. And as before, we've got NC as the number of columns. NP row is this variable we use to arrange the subplots. So this first block of statements simply prepare us for doing the data reduction. Later, I'll show you kerfits, and I would recommend that you keep this block of data at least so far as calculating VAV. The second block of code is simply a loop that plots histograms in subplots. We set a constant Y limit so that we can more easily compare the values. And there's a rather long-looking text command, which basically locates a position in the plot and prints the value of T so that we can see which of the T values each histogram is for. The last statement, fprintf, prints the summary statistics for each of the temperature values. Here's the array of histograms from the set of data that I happen to have. Notice that the last lower right corner is empty. That's where that ceiling command comes in because I have an odd number of columns of data. We'll also notice that each of these little subplots, it looks a little crowded, but each of these little subplots has a very narrow range on the x-axis. So there's some spread, but there's very little overall variation in the values. So what this tells me is that this is a pretty good data set. We'll be able to use all of these columns in our calibration experiment. We don't have to delete one because it's got bad data in it. So at this point, we've examined our data by looking at the histograms. The calibration data all looks good because there's little variability. And since there's little variability, we're going to use the mean of the analog input readings at each temperature as the variable, as the quantity used in our kerfits. So taking a step back and thinking about the salinity sensor, we note that the thermistor calibration experiment is both easier to execute, it's easier to carry out, and the results are cleaner in general than the calibration of the salinity sensor. This concludes the first phase of our data analysis. We've confirmed using histograms that the data is all good, and we can use the mean of each column of our calibration data for a curve fit, which will be the second part of our analysis.